In today's video, I want to talk about the ways in which psychedelic drug use can change our personality structure. At first glance, it might seem a little jarring to think that a single event can be so profound that it can permanently alter our default patterns of thinking, feeling, and behaving, so much so that it constitutes, you know, an observable personality change. But consider the veteran who comes back from the front lines of war, forever a changed person, perhaps somebody who is now in a constant state of fight or flight. We know that trauma can change us in profound ways, but what about mystical experiences if we were to see them as, in some ways, the inverse of trauma? I want to tell you about a person that I met last month at the dog park, and we'll call him Bob. I ended up talking to Bob for over an hour, and our conversation took a turn when the subject of psychedelics was brought up. Bob is a former heroin addict, and 20 years ago, he had an opportunity to participate in an Ibogaine ceremony led by a shaman. Ibogaine, as some of you guys might know, is a naturally occurring psychedelic substance found in the West African plant Iboga. This is what Bob told me had happened to him while he was on his Ibogaine trip. He was able to go back in time and revisit traumatic memories of his past and select different outcomes. He was even able to relive certain events from the perspective of other people who were involved. What had felt like an entire lifetime in this simulation really only spanned a mere matter of hours. But according to Bob, these were the most profound handful of hours of his life. This ceremony took place over 20 years ago, and in the time since, Bob has never touched heroin again, and he's not touched any hard drug for that matter. Not because he was able to muster up enough self-discipline to avoid his vices, but because he simply never felt a compulsion to reach for them again. Of course, today we're not talking specifically about addiction. I want to talk more broadly about the phenomenon of personality changes induced by psychedelics. So in this video, I'm going to cover three things. Number one, what a personality is, and we're going to brush up on the five-factor model so that we can all get up to speed. Number two, what the research says about the ways in which psychedelics can change our personality. There is a trait that seems to be particularly affected by psychedelics. So in the third section of this video, I want to talk about what this could mean for your subjective well-being, and also what it could mean for the collective, society, humanity. Why not? Let's raise the stakes. Let's go there. Great, you're still here. Let's start with what a personality is. In psychology, personality refers to patterns of thinking, feeling, and behaving that may distinguish a person from their peers. The consensus among psychologists is that an individual's personality structure remains more or less stable over the span of their lifetime, certainly after the age of 30. Following that, changes to your personality can occur, but they tend to occur more gradually, like in the case of adults becoming more set in their ways as they age, or in the event of trauma, like when somebody becomes more prone to stress after a traumatic brain injury. The Big Five personality model, or the five-factor model, is the most widely accepted personality taxonomy in the scientific community. According to this model, there are five distinct personality traits that every individual exhibits to some degree. They are openness to experience, conscientiousness, extroversion, agreeableness, and neuroticism. Openness to experience refers to the tendency to be open to new ideas and experiences, which tends to manifest as a preference for abstract thinking. More on that a little bit later. Conscientiousness describes a person's ability to come up with a plan and follow through on it. Extroversion refers to a person's inclination to seek stimulation from social interactions. Agreeableness describes a person's tendency to put the needs of others ahead of their own and the tendency to value cooperation over competition. Neuroticism refers to a person's inclination towards experiencing negative emotions like fear, anger, sadness, shame, and guilt. Somebody who has a high neuroticism score tends to react more negatively to a stressful event and is more likely to interpret a neutral event in a negative way. So it shouldn't come as a surprise that neuroticism is a particularly strong predictor of a whole host of mental health disorders like anxiety disorders, depression, substance use disorders, etc. Now we can ask the question of how psychedelics can change our personality. Let me begin by telling you about a study that was published in 2018 by researchers at Imperial College London. This study involved 20 participants with treatment-resistant depression who were given two doses of pure psilocybin 7 days apart. Each participant had an inventory of their personality taken twice, once before the experiment began and then again at the three-month follow-up. The researchers found that on average, the trait of neuroticism among participants had decreased from baseline, and meanwhile, the traits of extroversion, conscientiousness, and openness had all increased. Let me tell you about a meta-analysis that was published in the Journal of Psychopharmacology in 2011. This analysis combined the results of two studies involving a total of 52 healthy volunteers who completed 2 to 5 full-day drug sessions spaced at least 3 weeks apart. Among the participants, researchers found significant increases in the trait of openness following a high-dose psilocybin session. And number two, in participants who had mystical experiences during their session, the trait of openness remained significantly higher than baseline more than 1 year after the session had wrapped up. In the first study, we saw that in depressed patients, psilocybin therapy can lower the trait of neuroticism and increase the traits of extroversion, conscientiousness, and openness. In the second report, we saw that in healthy volunteers, psilocybin, and in particular, mystical experiences induced by psilocybin can significantly increase the trait of openness. So, what is openness exactly? Let's talk more about that. To better understand what this trait entails, let's take a look at the 6 different facets that make up the trait. They are active imagination, artistic interests, depth of emotions, willingness to embrace new experiences, intellectual curiosity, and tolerance for diversity. I know some places online will refer to that last facet, tolerance for diversity, as liberalism. And there's a reason why I chose tolerance for diversity over liberalism, because some people can get confused and they might think that liberal means Democrat. It doesn't necessarily mean that. In fact, we see that among people with a really high openness score, there's a representation of people who are fiscally conservative or libertarians. You also see social liberals, neoliberals, progressives, the whole gamut. You see people who don't identify as having any political affiliations at all. So what it really comes down to is, do you believe in individual liberty and equality before the law? If that's what you value, then in some way you can be described as a small L liberal. So hopefully that made sense and it wasn't too controversial. Now that that's out of the way, I want to explicitly state that increasing your openness score could be beneficial to your psychological well-being. People who are high in openness tend to be more creative and perform better on tests involving divergent thinking. They tend to exhibit higher levels of crystallized intelligence, which refers to the accumulation of knowledge and skills acquired throughout life. And this would make sense. If you're more intellectually curious, you tend to accumulate more knowledge. People who are high in openness also have a greater capacity for emotional depth and are more likely to experience mixed emotions. Anybody who's familiar with anxiety disorders will know how common the phenomenon of splitting is. Splitting refers to the interpretation of an emotionally charged event as either all good or all bad, which of course does no favor to your emotional health. We know that the world exists in shades of gray, so the more nuance you are able to see, the more nuance you are able to feel, and as a result, the better off you are. Now let's talk about the societal benefits of having a high openness score. And fair warning in this section, my commentary might verge on the territory of sounding a little political. And I want to say right off the bat that if you end up perceiving it that way, I totally understand if some people are going to be turned off by that. There are many in the psychedelic community who would prefer for content created in this space to be completely free from politics. And I understand the fear of alienating people and potentially slowing down the cause of psychedelic education. I completely get it. But at the same time, I have to say that the more I learn about psychedelics, the more passionate I become about my role as a global citizen. Politics to me isn't about political parties. It's about the way we affect society and the way society affects us, and government just happens to be a primary mechanism in this two-way relationship. Some people believe that the more enlightened thing to do would be to disengage from civil society altogether and behave as if you're above it all. So in other words, to drop out. And I think that's fine. if you live the rest of your days in seclusion away from the rest of us. But so long as you are here, so long as you are seeing this, you are a part of this too. And it should pain you to see how polarized we have become. I've been thinking a lot about this issue of polarization. And I think what it really boils down to is the feeling of contempt. Contempt as an emotion is not productive. It acts as a poison to the person who holds it. So it's already not productive on an individual level. But when it spills over, it boils over to the rest of society via the powerful mechanisms of government and media institutions. That is when contempt, the contempt that we feel, can become downright dangerous and destructive on a mass scale. People with contempt in their hearts tend to support government and media institutions that reflect how they feel, which is why we're now looking at some of our institutions and thinking, like, how the heck do we get here? You know, I used to have so much faith in institutions. Like, I used to be so idealistic about affecting change from the top down. I majored in political science in undergrad. That should tell you something about, you know, my former worldview. And in some ways, it still makes a lot of sense. If you want to make the world a better place, pass better legislation, disseminate better information, educate the masses. There's still a part of me that believes in that for sure. But it also seems that the older I get, the more cynical I become about placing my faith primarily in institutions. If you want to improve the health of institutions, to improve the health of the people, what if you could turn your attention to the emotional health of individuals first? It's not far-fetched to think that a viable way forward would be to improve the emotional health of the people who need it most. We have a solution for this. It's in the psychedelic renaissance. Just imagine if people who hold contempt in their hearts could be granted an opportunity to release it. Imagine if the people who exist on the fringes of society could be brought back into the fold, not by force, not by fear, but by an opportunity to experience an integration of their soul and the oneness of all of existence. I get that if I were talking to any other audience, it would sound like a bunch of hippy-dippy, you know, platitudes. But it's, to me, these aren't platitudes. I see this as perhaps the most viable way forward. What we really have here is we have medicine for the soul. This is how Albert Hoffman referred to LSD, for example. Psychedelic therapy is medicine for the soul, and it could be made available to the masses, and anybody who is curious about it can experience it. I just think healing on a mass scale and the ways that it truly counts is so much more accessible than we think, than most people think. And at the very least, as global citizens in the West, because of course I'm speaking from the perspective of somebody who lives in the West, we owe it to ourselves to at least think about psychedelics as a path forward to so many issues that currently weigh heavily on our hearts. I hope that made sense. It's past 1 a.m. I don't know if you guys know this, so I'm just completely beaten. I'm out. I'm gonna end the video here. Hopefully this made sense to you guys. Hopefully I didn't sound like I was just talking out of my ass, but heck, you know what? If you think that that's what I'm doing now, leave me a comment. Let's talk about it. If you also got what I was trying to say, let me know as well. I'm all ears, and I will see you guys next week.